The year 1908. Tommy Burns is heavyweight champion of the world. And finally, Johnson chases Burns all the way down to Australia in pursuit of the title heavyweight champion of the world.
It's been a long way, a long, long way. I was born in Texas 30 years ago. What I've seen, where I've been, it seems like 50. I want something, and I want it bad.
In Sydney, Johnson captures the fancy of promoter Hugh McIntosh. Johnson versus Burns. Tommy Burns, king of the heavyweights. At 5'7 and 175 pounds, Tommy Burns is the smallest champion in history. But in the public mind, the true champion of the universe is undefeated, though retired, James J. Jeffries. Burns spars with Al Kaufman, a huge, tough heavyweight. Novelist Jack London will cover the fight for the New York Herald. 17 miles away, the Challenger trains.
I've been to Ireland, I've been to England, I've been to France, and this time I won't go home empty-handed.
December 26th, 1908, Rush Cutters Bay at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Round one. 26,000 fans hold their breath. Burns is defending for the 12th time. At 6 feet 1 and 212 pounds, Johnson is lean and hard, a master craftsman who loves to set his own pace. Burns looks for an opening but is tied up.
Mr. Tommy, this sure is a lovely day.
The challenger moves the champion around at will. The man in the white suit, promoter Hugh McIntosh.
Show me $35,000 worth, Mr. Tommy. You sure bounce easy.
The press knows this will be a long afternoon. Now Johnson pours it on. Lifts, rights, hooks, uppercuts. Burns is defenseless. At this very moment, the police shut off the cameras and stop the fight. Jack London splashes his indignation across the front page of the New York Herald. Jack London decides Jim Jeffries must leave his farm and wipe that golden smile off Johnson's face.
We land in San Francisco, my manager and me. No family, no friends, no welcoming committees. It's as if I had never won the title.
Back in 1898, 10 years before he beat Tommy Burns, Johnson was a carefree touring fighter, fought in logging camps and lonesome frontier towns. Johnson got married to a girl from Galveston, his hometown. But life with a touring fighter was harsh and friendless. Mary Johnson went back to Texas. They never lived together again. In 1902, while fighting in Colorado, Johnson met another woman.
And what a time she gave me. Clara. Miss Clara Kerr. She ran off to St. Louis with another man. That's the last black woman I'll ever trust.
It is now 1909. Jack Johnson, the new heavyweight champion, goes wherever he can get a fight. Cowboy boots that add 5 inches. Colmo, California, October 16th, 1909. Rumor has it that Johnson will carry Ketchum to make it look good for the cameras. The first suspicion of a fix in Jack Johnson's career, but not the last. When Ketchum appears in the ring, minus shoulder pads and cowboy boots, the physical differences are startling.
Be careful. This man's a champion, and champions know what it's all about. Better behave now, Stanley.
A combination of blows, and Ketchum goes down. By round nine, Ketchum is exhausted. Courage, raw courage, keeps him on his feet.
Don't go down yet, Stanley. We got a little way to go.
Ketchum's face begins to show blood. Johnson stands off and flicks stinging left jabs. Ketchum looks for that one punch. Johnson steps back from a wild left and then ties up the challenger.
Easy, Stanley.
Been worse
for round 12. Kitchell throws an overhand right, and Johnson goes down. Kitchell has done it. Johnson rolls over and rises. And lightning strikes. Kitchell is down.
In slow motion, all of Kitchell's weight is behind one looping right. Slowly, Johnson begins to gather himself. He seems dazed. Ketchel's confidence soars. A perfectly timed straight right to the jaw smashes Ketchel to the canvas. Johnson's momentum sends him hurtling over the fallen Ketchel. Johnson wipes two of Ketchell's teeth from his glove. With shocking suddenness, Jack Johnson knocks out Stanley Ketchell and successfully defends his heavyweight crown.
Jim Jeffries, come back. Jim Jeffries, we need you. Put Jack Johnson in his place. Retired to the life of gentleman farmer, Jeffries takes on a new dimension. At 35, he is no ordinary mortal. He is James J. Jeffries, undefeated heavyweight champion, the fabled Boilermaker, the great white hope. And with visitors who seek him out, he enjoys the hero's prerogative of the practical joke. Jim Jeffries has been out of action 5 years. He has ballooned to 320 pounds, more than 100 pounds over his fighting weight. John L. Sullivan, elder statesman of boxing, publicly phones Jeffries to leave the farm. Though completely out of condition, Jeffries says, "I'll leave the farm if someone can meet my price." Offers pour in. From out of the Klondike comes a professional gambler who meets all the requirements. Age of confusion calls for cunning. The outrageous offer, the impossible deal. For Tex Rickard, gold and virility are the universal symbols.
Sure, I'll fight Mr. Jeffries. Name your figure, tell me the place, I'll be there.
$20,000 in gold pieces. Rickard gives Johnson the $10,000 bonus each fighter receives. To make this the biggest gate of all time, Rickard knows he needs the New York press. But the New York District Attorney says, no. Rickard is a smooth operator. He books rooms across the river in Hoboken. The signing is historic. Never has so much been guaranteed for a single event. $101,000. 60% to the winner, 40% to the loser, and $50,000 to each for the motion picture rights. On a brisk morning in December, it is made official. Jim Jeffries to meet Jack Johnson in San Francisco on the 4th of July, 1910. The Battle of the Century. The eyes of the world are on San Francisco. White fans rush to buy tickets. Tex Rickard has the touch of promotional genius. For the first time in history, a stadium is being built for a sing contest. California becomes the target of incredible pressure. This is the 20th century. Stop the fight. Jeffries goes into seclusion. This is the biggest battle of his life. A handball court is built for the express purpose of helping the retired champion to shed more than 100 pounds of fat. Timing, strength, rhythm. These he must master before he can reclaim his crown.
Sixers are on a rampage. A million letters are sent to Governor Gillette. Stop this pagan fight. The bombshell hits. Governor Gillette cancels the fight.
I knew we'd run into trouble. California only sees black. They may talk purity, but in their hearts there is hate.
The following day, a crowd gathers. Johnson is leaving. Tex Rickard has made a deal with the governor of Nevada. The fight will be held in Reno.
I'll fight Jim Jeffries anytime, any place.
Goodbye, California. Reno. Sporting fans rush. Johnson, it is the final lap. He spars with veteran Al Kaufman.
He's big, he's tough. He's the kind of man who can give me the test I need.
As July approaches, Reno becomes the hub of the universe. The Johnson Club, a place to quench a thirst and place a bet. Reporters flock to Jeffries' camp. The New York Times correspondent, none other than John L. Sullivan, the bulky man on the right. Sullivan spars with gentleman Jim Corbett. In the cause of solidarity, all must be forgiven. So ends a 17-year feud between these legendary figures. On the day of the fight, trains arrive every half hour. High society comes in private cars, lending a touch of elegance rare on the prairie. A complete sellout. Extremists spread ugly rumors. If Jeffries doesn't do the job, a gunman in the crowd will. At precisely 1:03, Jack Johnson makes his way to the ring. Johnson is always the first to enter. So seriously does he take this ritual that it's written into his contract. The nation comes to a standstill as cameras grind away. A roar goes up. Now, Jeffries. The crowd goes wild. Is a new age of instant communication. For the first time ever, a round-by-round account relayed across country by telegraphers key. Round one, 45 rounds, the battle of the century. The action is tentative, cautious. Two champions, one old and coaxed out of retirement,
acclaimed as the Great White Hope. The other, proud and outspoken, a man who has aroused the nation. The third man is Tex Rickard, impresario extraordinaire. While outside, hundreds unable to buy tickets await the outcome. Jeffries bears the reputation of being the strongest man ever to enter the ring.
Well, I got a thing or two to say about that.
In Jeffries' corner, Corbett yells, 1-2, Jeff, 1-2.
That's all you need, Jeff. 1-2, 1-2, keep on trying. Come on, man, do something. This is for the championship.
Around 7, Jeffries is beginning to show frustration. Each time he launches an attack, Johnson quickly stifles it. And his frustration is compounded by Johnson's taunts.
Strong, Mr. Jeff, real strong. Fighting me was wrong.
It's all on film for the world to see. And high overhead, a desert sun scorches the canvas. The temperature's rising, and so are tempers. The bell rings for round 15. A vicious uppercut and three stinging lifts. Jeffries goes down. The Great White Hope lies gasping against the rope. It is as if a moment in time has stopped. A right uppercut. Three quick lefts. Johnson moves in, but Rickard waves him off. Slowly, Jeffries rises. Johnson unloads a thunderous left, and Jeffries goes through the rope. Emotions wave the rules as Jeffries is helped to his feet. Johnson moves in to finish it. Jeffries finally collapses from a combination of blows. Stop it. Stop it, they scream. Johnson wants more, but Tex Rickard signals the end. The Great White Hope. Humiliated. Beaten. Betrayer of his race. On the morning of July 5th, the nation is stunned by riot, fire, and the face of death. Hundreds are wounded. At least 10 are killed. City after city refuses to show the Johnson Jeffries film for fear of new violence. As a result, Congress passes a law barring fight films from interstate commerce. Following Reno, Johnson stops in Chicago to see his mother, and then leaves for Europe. When Johnson leaves England, he aims right for America's midsection. Chicago!
Jack Johnson is a man like no other man. I'll love him to the end of my days.
Johnson marries Etta Terry Duryea. In the fall of 1911, Johnson opens a drinking establishment called the Café de Champion.
I spend money because it makes me feel good. To hear people laugh. To see women smile. To eat the best and drink the best. If you can't have the best, what good is living?
His young bookkeeper is impressed. Her name is Lucille Campbell. Reformers are on the move. Demon rum. Consorting with Satan. Lust. Vice. It is a head-on collision between the forces of virtue and the work of the devil. Militants like Carrie Nation believe that truth must triumph. But for Jack Johnson, life is now. Right now. Sheepshead Bay, 1911. America is obsessed with speed. And the great apostle of speed is Barney Oldfield, racing car driver par excellence. It seems inevitable that Barney Oldfield and Jack Johnson should meet, and meet they do, in one of the most extraordinary match races of all time. Drivers roll the dice for pole position.
Behind the wheel, that is. Mr. Barney Oldfield, meet Mr. Jack Johnson, and may the best man win.
Come on, Barney, turn it on. Show him what you've got. Oldfield's knocks on the outside. Are delirious. Barney Oldfield has done it. He beat Jack Johnson. Even though it's not on the ring, he's their own white hope. If there's one thing Johnson admires, it's a man with an open checkbook. Promoter Jack Curley comes forward. Johnson agrees to fight fireman Jim Flynn. The champion will get $30,000 and one-third of the motion picture rights. This, despite the fact that Congress has outlawed fight films.
I need money. Lots of money.
Not only is Johnson out of money, but he is out of shape. It's been 2 long years since he was last in the ring. He trains with Marty Cutler for the fight, which is to be held in Las Vegas, New Mexico, on July the 4th, 1912. Las Vegas, New Mexico is only a railroad town between Chicago and California. Reformers sweep in like torrential rain. Railroad men threaten to strike. When the Motion Picture Trust cancels its contract, Jack Curley searches frantically to find a camera crew. Curley is persistent. Jim Flynn is our white hope. Johnson can be beaten. Finally, local authorities relent. Round one. Promoter Curley has found someone to man his camera. July 4th, 1912, exactly 2 years since Johnson sent Jim Jeffries into oblivion. But time has dulled his ringmanship. Give Johnson an audience, even a sparse one, and he rises to the occasion. When it pleases him, Johnson lands rapier punches on the pretender to his throne.
Fireman Jim Flynn, I'm going to put out your fire. This man is easier than I thought. Just rest your head on my glove.
Flynn is completely demoralized. Skeptics might find it hard to believe that this same Jim Flynn, 5 years later, will flatten Jack Dempsey in a single round. Exasperated and determined to do damage, Flynn leaves his feet and propels his head under the champion's chin.
This man jumps better than a kangaroo.
The referee has words with the challenger.
Come on, Jim. We're on camera. Let's get moving.
Now the referee is exasperated. We're using Marquess of Queensbury rules, the referee cautions. I want both of you to follow the rules. By round nine, there is no let up. Flynn is still using his head, and Johnson his defensive skills. Again, Flynn goes into his strange choreography. This time, the referee has much sterner words. What's this? A fourth man enters the ring. It's the sheriff who halts the proceedings. So once again, Jack Johnson wins by police intervention. When Johnson returns to Chicago, there is trouble. His wife goes into a deep depression. Locks herself in her room and writes a note.
I am a white woman, and all my misery comes from marrying a black man. Even black people despise me. I intend to end it all.
On the morning of September 11th, 1912, Etta Terry Johnson commits suicide. Rumors are rampant that Johnson's cafe is used for private debaucheries, that the black champion lures Caucasian beauties to exercise his considerable prowess. Mayor Harrison openly declares war on evil. The license for the Café de Champion is canceled. A Christmas reunion with his mother is grim. Lucille Cameron has been taken into custody. Chicago has its melodrama.
give me no peace at all.
Johnson is arrested and charged with violating the White Slavery Act. Finally, after 4 days, he is released on bail.
If it's a fight they want, I'll fight. Don't count me out yet.
A ceremony is held at his mother's house. When Lucille Cameron is released, Johnson marries his former bookkeeper. Now it is confirmed. Jack Johnson is evil. The prosecutor is furious. Johnson's new wife can't testify against him. Jack Johnson must be driven out of Chicago. The United States versus John Arthur Johnson. Howell reads the indictment, crossing state lines for prostitution, debauchery, unnatural acts. Enter Belle Schreiber.
Do you know Jack Johnson?
Yes.
How well?
How well do you know your wife?
Did he take you to California?
Yes, he did.
For what purpose?
He was fighting Stanley Ketchel.
Are you a fight fan?
No, not exactly.
Where else did he take you?
New York. Pittsburgh, Milwaukee.
When Jack Johnson took you to California, where were you employed?
The Everly Club.
And what is the Everly Club?
A house of women.
And why are the women there?
For men.
2 weeks later, Johnson leaves the side door of the courthouse. The verdict still ringing in his ears.
Guilty. $1,000 fine and a year and a day in jail. How can she do this to me? She must be jealous. They're all jealous.
Rube Foster's in town with his Black Giants, a barnstorming baseball team. Rube Foster urges Johnson to leave.
You're black. That's what they all say. You're black and you ain't got a chance. Leave while the leaving's good.
A plan, a scheme. The cloak and dagger aspects appeal to Johnson's sense of the dramatic. A cap on his head, a load of bats in his arms, he jumps on the train just as it pulls out. Who would believe that the Giants' bat boy is Jack Johnson?
You're black, man, you're black. Better get going while the going is good. You're black, man, you're black. Better get going while the going is good. You're black, man, you're black. You better get going while the going is good. You're black, man, you're black. You better get going while the going is good. You're black, man.
When the train gets to Montreal, a boat will carry him to safety.
We boarded the Corinthia in Montreal. Lucille, my nephew Gus, and me. It's the roughest, longest voyage of my life. Once we're out to sea, there's no turning back. Lucille is seasick and too nervous to go on deck. Passengers stare, so we stay in our... No one seems to be in a hurry. Wherever you go, people are having a good time. Inside me, I feel it. I can almost taste freedom. And make a quick trip to England. Music halls are going strong. Lucille and me do our act. I play the bass fiddle and Lucille recites.
Twenty rounds for the heavyweight championship of the world. Sheik Paris turns out. Maurice Chevalier, Rothschilds, and Miss Tenguet are in the audience. It is a gala evening. The bell for round one. Neither Johnson nor Moran seem eager to launch the festivities. The fighters are told to break, and Johnson lets go with an uppercut. Moran feels that he's been fouled. Moran will have none of that, and continues only after the referee urges him back into the contest. The referee, 19-year-old Georges Carpentier. Moran lets go with an overhand left. Johnson, unbelievably, applauds.
Très bien, Frank. Très bien.
By round 20, the final round, Johnson's confidence gives way to caution. Using every move he knows, he stays away from a determined Moran. At the end of round 20, Johnson is awarded the decision by the slimmest of margins. Johnson prepares to leave for South America when an old friend shows up.
Good old Jack Curley.
Money. A chance to make big money if Johnson is willing to fight Jess Willard. For Johnson, it is the right time to leave Europe, even though crossing the high seas offers new dangers. April 5th, 1915. Round one. 45 rounds for the heavyweight championship of the world. Johnson is calm. He's been to the post before. He sees an opening and goes to his man. Willard ties him up and pushes off. Willard concentrates. This is the man who sent Jeffries into oblivion. Johnson looks for an opening. Willard keeps his distance with his great reach advantage. Johnson bombards the challenger, hoping for a first round knockout. Johnson is neutralized. The end of round one. It is hot and getting hotter. High overhead, the Cuban sun glares relentlessly. By round 10, it becomes a bitter struggle. Each man trying to establish superiority. Willard advances cautiously. Johnson is confident. To friends in Chicago, he wired, "We'll win in 15th round." Johnson goes after Willard, and again he's tied up. Willard is no Burns. Willard is no Flynn. This giant is an immovable object.
Look out, I'm coming at you, Jeff.
Of toil, the chance of a lifetime. Willard is not about to back down. Johnson looks tired.
by round 20. They've been in the ring for more than an hour. It is brutally hot. The spring in Johnson's legs is gone. He stands flat-footed, conserving energy. Now Willard begins to score, spotting openings.
You ain't supposed to be standing. I've got to win. Promise my friends in Chicago.
Crudely, Johnson holds on, reaching for time, gathering strength.
Mr. Willard, you're big and tall, and I'm going to make you fall. This man is tough. Willard won't quit.
Still the showman. Johnson spreads his gloves, but the challenger ignores his cue.
The years, where have all the years gone? I gotta put it together here and now. Everything I know.
Willard is respectful. Johnson is a man like no other man. Round 26. The sun is insidious. Jess Willard has the will to win. Though muscles signal their discontent, Johnson finds the stamina to launch an attack. Leaning, pushing, shoving, holding on.
This heat's getting me. My arms are like lead, and my legs won't move. I can hardly breathe. Don't Willard feel this heat?
Willard sees Johnson's eyes. They tell him now is the time. Johnson goes down. It's happened. The crowd roars his approval. In slow motion, Willard, poised, confident. Then a piston-like right finds Johnson's jaw. He starts his descent, instinctively clutches at the giant, pulling him into the ropes. A photograph taken at this instant will give birth to the biggest controversy in boxing history. The tension in Johnson's legs releases. Six, seven, eight, nine, ten. It's over. Oh. Anger, hate, passion. All somehow appeased by one paralyzing blow on a torrid afternoon in Havana. Jess Willard is hugged, pummeled, acclaimed. Hero, saint, redeemer. The great white hope has finally arrived. Johnson sails back to Europe, to Spain, where it is warm, and where war has yet to cast its shadow of death. Spain is quiet. Johnson sits down and begins to write.
I threw the fight in Havana. There was a deal. If I lost to Willard, they would let me back into the States. I wanted to see my mother. She was sick and getting old. My wife was supposed to get $50,000. I was shielding my eyes from the sun. Willard didn't beat me. I decided to lay down.
Johnson peddles his confession. He needs money. He is still a fugitive. There's no evidence of the $50,000 he was supposed to have received. In Madrid, he beats Frank Crozier in 10 rounds, a victory that stirs barely a ripple.
And in Barcelona, a one-round knockout over Arthur Craven. America's entry into the war brings a surge of intrigue in Spain. Johnson makes contact with espionage agents who roam the Spanish coast. His role as agent or double agent shall forever remain a mystery, locked in the secret files of the State Department. At war's end, the action shifts to Mexico, which becomes a gathering place for poets, treasure hunters, and adventurers. Johnson opens a cafe and rents this modest home on the edge of Tijuana. Working for pesos, trying to make out on a reputation that is beginning to fade into legend. Finally, a decision is made. For a man in his early 40s, it could be the last chance to go home. On July 20th, 1920, Johnson surrenders to border police. It is a ride back into time, as if all that has happened is somehow unreal. At station after station, crowds gather to catch a glimpse of the fabulous former heavyweight champion. This man, the likes of whom America had never seen before, finally is home. Jack Johnson has returned. Physical director. Jack Dempsey has disposed of Jess Willard. Johnson still thinks he's the best.
Jack Dempsey? He's only an in-between champ. I can take him.
Time served, the slate is clean. Jack Johnson is now 43. On July 9th, 1921, Johnson is released from Fort Leavenworth. Friends carry the basket of gloves he used behind the walls of Leavenworth. If prison leaves any bitterness, there is no evidence. He bids farewell to the warden's son.
Even a little bit slower, but still I've done what no one else has done, and I can do it again.
Harlem has replaced Chicago. Men like Marcus Garvey tell black people their future is in separation, separate demonstrations, separate militias, separate medical facilities. But to the people of Harlem, a parade is a parade. Now Jack Johnson comes to Harlem, where he's given a tumultuous welcome. This one man tells it better than anyone else. Tells it like it was. And tells it how it might be. Jack Johnson. The great Jack Johnson. Finally given his due.
I'm a fighter. I always was, and I'll always be. Fighting is my business.
In the middle 20s, Johnson continues fighting, driven by ego, spurred by the memory of a time when he could beat anyone. But life goes on. People change. In 1925, Lucille Johnson files for divorce. The grounds? Infidelity. This is the age of jazz, an age that Johnson has already lived a generation ago. America is having the time of its life, dancing, drinking, building mythical fortunes. It's a time of speakeasies and easy money. It's a time to have fun. It's a time when anything is possible. Charles Lindbergh, the lone eagle, soars through night and fog to link the old world and the new. In Paris, tens of thousands embrace a hero who has brought them a great moment in history. Johnson is in Paris at this time, a familiar face in bistros off the Champs-Élysées. He has a new wife, Irene Pinault. A pattern has been established. They met at the racetrack. The middle 30s. It is no longer the era of the great white hope. Joe Louis becomes heavyweight champion of the world. His is a different style. All that Joe Louis has to say is said in the ring. His private life is private. His talent, undisputed. His demeanor, a model for all. Jack Johnson is still public. Wherever the action is, there he goes. Jack Johnson, former heavyweight champion of the world, still needs an audience. This man of the world will let you in on his secrets for a dollar.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
World War II, another war, another world, another America.
Suddenly and deliberately attacked.
We are fortunate in having, in this corner, the greatest exponent of adventure boxing the ring has ever seen, Jack Johnson.
I want to say a few words in regard to boxing here today. I should not be here, but I am here. I want to do something good. And out of doing that something good, something will come good to me. Now then, I am boxing a fellow here, Joe Jeanette, who some 35 or 40 years ago, Joe and I used to have some tough scraps. But even so, with all our fights, we have retained our friendship.
1945. Johnson is 67. Jeanette, 71. A war bond rally is held in New York. Jack Johnson, now recognized as the greatest heavyweight champion of all time. Before Johnson was champion, he fought Joe Jeanette 9 times. Now a nostalgic reunion. Jeanette,
never got a chance at the title.